You know, this is my second time speaking at USANA. I know this is like a family, so every time I come here, I feel welcome. This is also the second time I speak in Malaysia. I love Malaysia. So, who's from Malaysia here? Alright. I love you here. Also, how many of you speak Chinese?
Wow!
你会讲中文的吗?
Wow!
Alright. 很高兴我也会讲中文，待会儿结束之后跟我照相的时候，如果大家愿意跟我讲中文，我也很开心。So, I know this is USANA. Everyone loves it here. But you know what people don't love? Rejection. Well, I hope by the end of this talk, you will start loving rejection. That's my goal. Two hands. Okay, put out two hands.
Yes.
On one hand is ambition.
One hand.
The type of goals you're trying to achieve in life. The other hand is resilience. It's the ability for you to keep going after even you get rejected. You can measure which one is higher and lower. The thing is, our achievements don't reach the height of our ambition. They match the depth of our resilience. The goal of this talk is for you to raise your resilience so you can match your ambition, so you can achieve your goals. You can put down your hands now. Before I start, I'll tell you how I started. I grew up in Beijing, China. I had a pretty good childhood, but one day, my first grade teacher came up with this brilliant idea. Brilliant. That she wanted us to get holiday gifts, but also learn to praise each other at the same time. So she had all of us come to the front of the classroom. There were 40 of us. She said, why don't you just all go to the front? And then she bought all of us gifts and stacked them in the corner. She said, hey, why don't you guys say nice things about each other? If you hear a name called by someone else, you can go pick up a gift and sit down. What a great idea, right? What could go wrong? When it started, it was great. Every time I heard someone's name was in the most called, I'll be like, yay, great. Like, for example, Peter is a good student, or Mary is good at math, or Susie can sing really well, and they will go get a gift and sit down. I'll be like, yay, good for you, but when is my turn? And then there were 20 people left, and 10 left. At the end, there were only 3 kids left. That's where the praise stopped, just silence. And guess what? I was one of them. At that moment, I didn't want to give anymore. I didn't want to praise anymore. I just want to sit down. I had no idea why no one was saying anything nice about me. I thought that was cool. I thought I was a popular kid. Then I saw the 2 kids standing next to me. I knew otherwise because I hated those 2 kids. And the teacher, she was freaking out. She was like, oh my God, will anyone say anything nice about these people? No? All right, why don't you just go grab a gift and sit down? What does it say about you? You know, you guys behave better next year, so someone says something nice about you. You know, as I'm describing this, it's like happened to me yesterday, right? Ever since that day, I would just die not to be in that situation again, getting rejected in public. But that's only one version of me. The other version of me, I had a lot of ambition. Oh yeah, I did have a lot of ambition. I want to do amazing things. When I was 14, I met this guy. Do you know who he is? Okay. Anyone shout it out?
Steve.
Bill Gates, that's right. Bill Gates, he came to China to promote Windows 95. I know I'm dating myself. I heard him speak and I loved that guy. I loved everything about him. His entrepreneur story and the idea of using technology to change the world. So that night I wrote a letter to my family telling them, hey, don't worry about me. I got my life figured out. By age 25, I'll build the biggest company in the world, and I'll buy Microsoft.
Wow. Okay.
I didn't make this up. I did write that letter for, my family kept the letter for me all those years. They sent it to me when I was 30. They're like, have you done this? So this is what the letter looks like. Some of you might be able to read this. I get embarrassed when I show this letter. For those of you who don't know, who can't read Chinese, don't worry about it. It's not really beautifully written. You know, Chinese is better looking than this. But I did highlight some keywords for you, so you know what I'm talking about in this letter. In that letter, I also mentioned someday I want to go to the United States to fulfill that dream. You know, because that's where Bill Gates lived. I want to beat him on his home turf. And 2 years later, I had my chance to go to the United States as a high school student. When they called me, by the way, growing up, when I think about America, I look at America through the lens of Hollywood movies. This is my favorite movie. Any of you have seen this movie before? True Lies? Okay. Those of you who haven't, if the only thing you'll take from this talk is go watch True Lies, your life will be better. It's a great movie. In that letter, Arnold Schwarzenegger, there was a scene, he was chasing bad guy, riding on a horse, jumping between buildings. I was like, this is so beautiful. If that's America, that's where I need to be. And 2 years later, when I was 16, I went to the United States as a high school student. But when I went, I was like, where am I gonna go? Am I gonna go to Los Angeles, New York City, Chicago, San Francisco? Nope, they told me I'm going to Simpson, Louisiana. Okay, for those of you who know what Simpson, Louisiana is like, this is what it looks like. This is the hometown Simpson, that's it. I got this on Google. It's just like that. There are more cows than people in that town. And I'm like, okay, this is a different America than I thought. But it's okay, I'm gonna start small, and someday I'll make it big. Like this great entrepreneur, starting from a small town that made it big. That was when I was 16. And then fast forward another 14 years, when I woke up, I was 30. Nope, I didn't build the biggest company in the world. I didn't even start. I mean, I did okay for myself. I went to school, I found a job, I made money, bought a dog, bought a house, bought a car. Kind of fulfilled this everything in this picture, the American dream. No, that's not my house, by the way. So it's a nice house, but it's a great dream. It's a dream that a lot of people want to have, but it's not my dream. Where was the kid who wrote that letter? He wanted to change the world. And, when I was 30, then I heard the news from my wife that we're gonna have a baby. Yay. I mean, don't get me wrong, I love babies, you know. I would recommend babies to all of you when the timing is right. But the thing is, when you become a father, this chance of you becoming this world-changing entrepreneur goes way down. Your responsibility changed, your priorities changed. So, I told my wife, Tracy, and I was like, hey, maybe I'm old. Maybe I shouldn't try this anymore. Maybe I will be a good provider. I'll do well at my job, so someday my kids will become entrepreneurs. When I said this, my wife told me, hey, when I first met you, all you talked about were your business ideas. You want to do this, you want to be independent. You want to do all of this business. I want to have that guy back. If you want to do this, why don't you just go quit your job and start doing your business? Okay, you don't have to do this forever. How about you try this for 6 months. If by the end you reach your goals, you can keep going. Otherwise, you can look for a job again. You know, there are many times in my life I felt I married up. This is one of them. So this was the day my son was born. I live in Austin, Texas. I don't know how many of you have been to Texas, but I lived in Austin, Texas at the time, and this is the day my son was born. And 4 days before that, I quit my job to start my own company. So I hit the ground running. So one thing to start a business, another thing is to actually build a business. So I built a team of 4 engineers. We're building this mobile app, and we were finding customers, we're prototyping, and then 4 months into my venture, it got real. Because a local investor showed interest in my company. I really thought he was gonna invest. In fact, I dreamed about the moment that he was going to invest in my company. And there was dreams, and then the reality. The reality is one day, I was at the restaurant celebrating a friend's birthday. There was singing, there was happiness all around me. Then my phone vibrated, and I saw it was the email from this investor. So I put it out, I was like, oh, I hope it's something good. So I clicked the email open, It was one liner. I said, nope, we're not doing this. It didn't tell me why he wouldn't invest in me. He wouldn't tell me how I could get it. It just said no. At that moment, I have to just walk out so people wouldn't see me crying in front of them. I didn't know why I was hurt that bad that day. But at that moment, the 6-year-old was standing my shoulder again, just whispering to my ears. He was like, who do you think you are? You want to be an entrepreneur? That's for the geniuses. You are just a fake. You should quit now before you embarrass yourself more. That's where it dawned on me. Would Bill Gates want to give up after rejection like this? Would anyone successful at anything want to give up after rejection like this?
No.
No way. I can keep going. I can build a better team, a better product. But one thing for sure, I got to be more brave. I got to solve that rejection problem. I got to put that 6-year-old back to his place so he wouldn't talk to me like this again and again. So what did I do? I searched online, you know, I used Google. I searched how to overcome my fear of rejection. I saw a bunch of articles written by psychologists and written by motivational speakers that were just telling me, hey, don't take rejection personally, just move on. You can overcome this. I was like, who doesn't know this? If we're that simple, why was that still so afraid? Then I saw a website that got me interested. It's called rejectiontherapy.com. For those of you who don't know, rejection therapy, if you can put that on the screen. Rejection therapy is this game invented by this Canadian entrepreneur. He's got some real rejection issues. That's why he invented this game. There are 30 cards. Each card will give you a suggestion to get rejected at something. The idea is if you're afraid of rejection, why don't you, instead of running away from it, why don't you just go look for rejection? If you do this for 30 days, by the end, you'd be able to desensitize yourself from the pain. You become this badass. You know, I'm like, this is the best idea I've ever heard. I want to be a badass. You know, I want to be the baddest ass of them all. So I said, I'm going to do this, but I'm not going to do this for 30 days. How about if I do this for 100 days? How about if I want to overdose on rejection? I want to see what kind of a badass I become. Also, instead of doing this by myself, what if I film myself doing this? And I'll put this on YouTube so people will hold. If I do this by myself, I'll quit pretty easily. But if I show this to the world, people will hold me accountable. So that's what I did. So I call this 100 days of rejection therapy. I start filming myself. So day one, borrow $100 from a stranger. Okay, all right. So I live in Austin at the time, Texas at the time. So one day before going home, I said, I'm gonna do this. Who do I talk to? Then I saw a guy sitting in the lobby of a hotel and in my office. I'm like, I'm gonna ask him. He was a big guy. He looked like a security guard, okay? I said, okay, I'm gonna ask him, no problem, I can do this. Yeah, I'm just pumping myself up. Yeah, I can do this. So I just start walking toward him. I can do this. Then as I start walking, he started looking bigger and bigger, you know. And when I got there, I started to sweat. My heart started to pound. The hair at the back of my neck stood up. When I got there, I was a mess. I was like, sir, can I borrow $100 from you? He looked up, he was like, no. Why? I said, no, sorry, no, bye. I just turned around and ran as fast as I could. Because I was so scared. But the thing about doing a vlog is, everything experienced, you gotta experience it at least twice. Because that night, I have to upload the video to YouTube. I gotta see myself. First of all, I saw myself. I was so scared. My face was pale, and I couldn't speak well. Then I saw this guy. He was a big guy. He was security guard, and he said no to me. But he wasn't mean. He wasn't calling me names. He didn't use pepper spray. He didn't call the police. All he did was to say no, and he asked me why. In fact, he was trying to ask me to explain myself. I could have said many things. I could be like, well, I'm trying to overcome my fear of rejection here. Or I could be like, well, I'm trying to have some fun. Or I could have said, if you can't do 100, can you do 50? 25? You can do $5, can you? What did I say in reality? I said just 4 words. No, sorry, no, bye. I'm like, wow, this is like the microcosm of my life. Every time I got the slightest rejection, I would just run as fast as I could because I was scared. So I said, tomorrow, no matter what happens, I'm not running. I'm gonna negotiate after rejection. So day two, get a burger refill. Let's take to lunchtime. So one day I got my a juicy cheeseburger for lunch. And afterward, I went and talked to the person, the front desk person. I said, can I get a burger refill? He was confused. He was like, what do you mean a burger refill? I was like, just like a free drink refill, but with a burger instead. He was like, sorry, we can't do a burger refill, man. That's where the rejection happened. But this time, I didn't run. I negotiated. I was like, hey, I love your burger. It's so good. If you give me a burger refill, I'll come back here every day for next week. I'll tell everyone about it. It's word of mouth marketing. It's not bad for a free burger. He was like, it's a good idea, but sorry, I can't do it for you. I can't give out free food or get in trouble with my manager. So I said, okay, no worry. That's where I left. And guess what? I wasn't scared anymore. I mean, still very awkward, but I found out that rejection doesn't automatically make us feel bad, but running away from it does. Oh, thank you. So as only 2 days into this venture, I learned this truth. Don't run away from rejection. Just stay and negotiate. Then as I kept doing this, so I started doing more things. One day, day seven, I tried to use the store speaker, you know, trying to talk to customers. I got a no. And day 37, I tried to get a haircut at the pet store. I got a no. But then as I kept doing this, it got more and more weird. People started to say yes to me, one after another. For example, one day I had this football in my hand. I went and knocked on a stranger's door. The guy at the door, I said, sir, can I play soccer in your backyard? And he was like, soccer in my backyard? And he looked at me. He saw I got a soccer ball, I got a shin guards and cleats and all decked out. And he was like, I guess so. Come on in. And I was like, now what? How do I play soccer with myself, football with myself in the backyard? So I just went in, I did a little bit dribbling. I asked him to take a picture of me. But before leaving, I asked him, how can you say yes to me? He was like, this is so off the wall, how can I say no? I'm like, okay. So I played football in someone's backyard. Then there's another day, I was driving, I saw a police car, and I waved at the police, and he waved back at me. No, I'm like, can you stop? So I pulled him over, and I said, officer, can I drive your car? By the way, I don't want to get in trouble. I'm not going to drive it away. I just want to listen to your radio. I'm going to give it a spin. And he was like, I've never heard this before. Sure, why not? So I drove a police car that day. There's another day I got a bunch of yeses in a row. I got frustrated. I'm like, this is rejection therapy, not acceptance therapy. What's one thing that no one's gonna say yes to me? How about if you try to fly a plane? By the way, I have no idea how to fly a plane. I just get rejected that day. So I went to an airfield in Austin. I saw a guy that looked like a pilot. I said, sir, do I have a plane? He's like, yes, I do. I said, can I fly it? He said, do you know how to fly? I'm like, nope. He's like, do you have a license or something? I'm like, no. He was like, have you ever been inside a cockpit before? I'm like, nope. He was like, all right then, let's do it. I'll teach you how to fly. You want to do it now? I'm like, why? What's going on? As it turned out, he didn't own a commercial jetliner. He owned a gyroplane. For those who don't know, a gyroplane is like a miniature helicopter or like a motorcycle in air type of thing. This is a rich hobbyist. He just bought his new gyroplane. He wants to show everyone how awesome it is. So he taught me how to fly. It was amazing. So I drove a police car and I flew a plane. By the way, if you go to YouTube, you can see all of them in videos. They're all pretty fun. But by the way, speaking of video, I do want to show you one video that really talks about this idea of looking for rejection but not getting it. This is the one day I went to a Krispy Kreme. If you don't know a Krispy Kreme, it's like a donut shop, right? They make donuts in the United States. I went there and asked them to make me some specialized donuts. And this is what happened.
I like to have you link the five donuts together, make them look like Olympic symbols.
And when are you looking to these?
Huh?
When?
The next 15 minutes.
And the video just stopped. That sounds like a rejection. So
Let's
do it again. Okay.
Getting a you link the five donuts together, make them look like Olympic symbols.
And when are you looking for these?
Huh?
When?
The next 15 minutes. Just normal color is fine.
You want the blank?
Yeah.
It's like I didn't even pay attention to the Olympics this year.
No, just you got five donuts together, look like a Olympic symbol.
Was it this way this year?
Something like that. That would work. Just link any five donuts together. It's going to be awesome.
It's going to take me longer.
How long?
Because I've got to catch them on the other side. And then they've got to get through the proofer and then drop through the fryer. It was red, blue, green, yellow. What's the other color?
Red, green, yellow, blue, maybe white?
Is it white?
Could be.
It's not correct. It's good one. Especially I haven't watched the Olympics in so long that I may not be able to link them, but maybe make them look like they're interlinked.
Okay, that would be great.
Because the only thing I'm worried about is if I try to put those through the proofer, they unsettle. The
okay.
And then once they hit the fryer, you've got a divider. And if they hit that, they're going to get stuck. You know what I'm saying?
If you can make that, you're going to make my day. Yep. Okay. No, it's good. It's good. It's more than I thought it would be done. So great. All right. So Jackie?
Yes.
All right, I'm a fan. Thank you.
You're way too kind.
No, you're really good. All right, so did I pay there?
Don't even worry about that. That one's on in.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
You serious?
Very. Extremely.
Wow.
That's my play.
All right, Jackie. I'll take it. But man, you're making me really happy today. All right. Thank you. All right.
see you. Give me a hug. Okay. All right. Thank you. See you. So these were the donuts. When I was walking out of the donuts shop in my, I just had tears in my eyes because I couldn't believe how nice she was. The kind of customer service or human kindness that you saw in this video. And also, I kept asking myself this question. How many yeses have we missed in my life because I assumed a no? So, and I couldn't believe this, and the world couldn't believe this either. After I put this video on YouTube, it went completely viral. It's got millions of views. It was in the United States, Canada, it was in India, it was in United Kingdom, it just went everywhere. And millions of views, and because of this video, people start sending me, they start sending me emails from all over the world. They're like, Jia, what are you doing looking for rejection? That is so awesome, so inspiring. I was like, I'm just looking for rejection. So I thought I was the only person afraid of rejection. As it turned out, everyone's afraid of rejection. And they're looking at my video. It's like some sort of therapeutic treatment. And then they start sharing stories with me. There are artists who saw this video. She started sharing her art. And then he got picked up by media. She was later on invited by the United States government to give a show in Washington, D.C. It changed her life. There are people who found new jobs. There are people who actually got promoted at work. There are people who started new businesses and podcasts. And I want to share this story with you. There's a person, name is Mark. He's in the same line of business as you. He's in sales. One day, Mark met me. He told me, at the time he saw this video, he was going through a very nasty divorce. In fact, he was very depressed. He was even didn't have a will to live anymore. Then he saw this video. He was like, okay, not only I need to have a will to live, I need to know how to get myself back together. So every day, he started his own challenge. He wanted to get a little bit uncomfortable every day. So the first day, he was taking a cold shower, just cold shower. It got me out of his bed. The second day, he went out on a run. Then I said, he kept doing this and doing this. He started to change. He started to gain more confidence. One day, he was at a coffee shop. He saw this beautiful woman. He was like, huh, I want to ask her out. But I just went through a divorce. It was, who am I? But you know what? He's doing rejection therapy. He needs to be uncomfortable. He needs to have the courage. He's not be afraid of rejection. So he went and asked the girl out. That was a few years ago. Mark told me, not only he got out of depression, he became one of the best performers at his company. Wow. And also, he met that girl he met that day became the love of his life. Wow. So, this is he invited me to his wedding. This is me taking his wedding, and it's me taking a picture with him. And a few years later, they have a beautiful daughter together. So, it is all these type of stories, personal stories, but also business stories. After I knew I was invited by USANA to give a talk, I talked to some of the best performers at USANA and talked to them about how they see rejection. And here's what they said. I met Lucas and Jane. They're an awesome couple here in Malaysia. Here's what they said. If you don't want to give up after rejection, be surrounded by others who don't give up after rejection. Environment is everything. You have a great team here. If you are afraid, surround yourself with the people who aren't afraid. And also, I talked to Changja and Hakbong. They're a great couple in Korea. They said, before quitting after rejection, ask yourself, have I given 100%? The answer is always no. Only quit after you have given everything. The next time if you feel you want to quit, ask yourself this question. Have you given everything? There's a lot of implications in personal lives and in business. So I spent the rest of 100 days of rejection to learn everything possible. By the way, if you want to, we have found a lot of tools where you can learn how to turn no into yes, how do you get more yeses, and how do you actually say no to others without offending them. How, you know, there are ways you can do it. You can make the other person a fan of you. There are a lot of different tools. If you want to get a tool, feel free to scan the QR code and type in your email. I'll send you a PDF of those tools I've found over the years. Now, I want to end this on one more story. Sometimes when you gain this power of rejection, you can change your life. It changed mine. Why am I here as a speaker? Over the years, I've gone to hundreds of events to speak to people about rejection. But you know what? I wasn't a speaker to begin with. I was so afraid of rejection. I was so afraid to be rejected in public. Every time they put me in front of a group of people, bad things happened. Remember the six-year-old? I was so scared. But I was invited to give a talk at this place. It's called TEDx Austin. It's a big event just like this in Austin, Texas, where some of the best speakers would come and give a talk. I was invited, and I didn't know what to do. I was scared. So I did the only thing to train myself to become more courageous, to gain the resilience. I did the only thing I learned from rejection therapy. I said, how about if I go to the street to speak to strangers, try to gain courage? So that's one day, my wife Tracy and I, we went to this is the Austin, Texas. We went there, we had this sign on a park that said, public storytelling at 7:30, stay if interested. So I sat there to see who'd be interested in just stopping by to hear my talk. No one did. People just kept walking. 7:30 came and went, not one person stopped. I took out eraser and checked the time from 7:30 to 7:50, give myself a little more time, no one came. So I said, okay, Tracy asked me, what do you want to do? I thought about going home, but I said, actually, there's no way after I learned rejection therapy, I would go home without someone actually saying no to me. So there are a couple of people walking by, I just went to them. I said, hey, I'm gonna give a talk, public storytelling. Do you want to stop by? Do you want to listen? They were like, sure. Okay, that's all I needed. Before they could say any more, I started giving my talk. And then I start sharing my story. Very quickly, two people become five, become 10. I drew a crowd. By the end, when I finished my talk, they applauded, gave me a standing ovation. I mean, they were standing there anyway. So they applauded and they say, bravo. That's my first talk on the street to strangers. And 10 days later, TEDx Austin, 1,000 people came. And it was some of the best speakers in town came. My talk was in the afternoon. I was so nervous that day because everyone before me, they did amazing things. They gave amazing talks. And who am I? I'm just a guy who go get rejected. So in the back, I was pacing back and forth. I was like, oh my gosh, what can I do? My mouth was dry. I didn't know what to do. The volunteer saw me and she was like, hey, can I teach you some yoga? You know, relax, because she was thinking, I bet she was thinking, if he faints here, if he passed out here, that's his problem. If you go on and pass out on stage, that becomes our problem. Then he asked me, are you the rejection man? I'm like, yeah, I'm the rejection man. Wait, the rejection man? Sounds like a superhero. That's like an Iron Man or Superman. I'm the rejection man. You know what? Maybe I'm not as polished or accomplished as all these other speakers were, but I bet none of them go out on the street of Austin to speak in public. I bet none of them go get rejected on purpose. I'm the freaking rejection man. When I said that, I felt I was putting on a cape on my shoulder. I felt so powerful. Then my name was called, just like this. I walked out to a beautiful stage just like this in front of thousands of people. For the next 15 minutes, I had an out-of-body experience. I was like floating before above me, watching myself speak. Just powerful words came out of me, eloquent words. When I was done, 1,000 people gave me a standing ovation. That was my first talk. That's my first public talk. It's me giving my TEDx Austin talk. And afterward, that was 10 years ago. In the meantime, after that, I wrote a book, wrote a best-selling book called Rejection Proof. I give a TED talk that has over 10 million people views on the website. A lot of people got to know me because of the TED talk. It's actually one of the most viewed TED talk of all time. And in 2019, I was given the Golden Gavel Award by Toastmasters International for communication and leadership. I became the only Asian to ever receive this award. Think about this. This immigrant who couldn't speak English, who went to America, later on was given this talk, and who given this award for communication, for giving speeches. People ask me, Jia, what's your highlight? When was your most proud moment? Was that the book, or the talk, or the award? I said, no, it was none of that. It was when I was finishing my first talk at TEDx Austin. I went home, right? Just after all the applause, and I saw my wife was waiting for me. My wife Tracy was waiting for me. She was in the car with me, and she told me, you did good. I'm so proud of you. You know, that's all that six-year-old ever wanted. And this time, he didn't have to be smart. He didn't have to be good at math. He didn't have to be good at singing. All he did was he was willing to go get rejected. I don't know what your dream is, what your ambition in life is. And just so you know, if you gain the power of resilience, you can do whatever you want.
Yes.
Just go get rejected. Thank you very much, guys. Woo! Thank you. Thank you for being my friend. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.